Hey there guys, Paul here. In this video, I'm going to be walking you through some examples for the general selection process of some different components. Coming up, we'll be looking at the selection process for valve and line components, compressors, electronic controllers, as well as generating a bill of materials and also generating a report. This video is part of a series where we'll be looking at a number of worked examples using the Coolselector 2 application to help you select and calculate components for your refrigeration system. So do check out the other videos if you haven't already. Links are in the video description below. We start the selection process for a valve and line component by clicking on the Valve and Line Components tab. In this example, we require a burnout filter, so we select the burnout filter category. We must always start from the top of the first segment, which is located on the left-hand side. At the top, you'll notice the application defaults to a dry system, which can be changed if needed. Under this, we have the system schematic. We can select where in our system the burnout filter will go. In this example, we'll choose the suction line. Next, we can choose the refrigerant and the connections used. I'll leave this as default for a moment, but we'll come back to this later on. Next, we have the product families. We can hover our mouse over the list to see an image of each type, as well as a short product description. For this example, we'll choose the DCRDA family by clicking on the title. As we click this, we see lots of new information appear in segments within the application window. This will suggest the best match using the default values in the operating conditions and selection criteria. We need to ensure that these are changed to reflect our conditions in order to find the most compatible product for our system. Increasing the capacity increases the mass flow rate, which will require a larger component. Decreasing the evaporator temperature increases the mass flow rate, as this decreases the coefficient of performance, which results in the requirement for a larger component. Decreasing the condensation temperature has the opposite effect and reduces the mass flow rate, meaning a smaller unit is required. As you can see, changing these values changes the suggested product. The product suggestion is based on the input in the selection criteria segment. In this case, by default, the selection is based on velocity. The product which matches the velocity and other operating conditions best is therefore automatically suggested. Coming back to the first section for system definition, if we now try to change this refrigerant to, for example, R404A, we will see a pop-up window appear. This will warn us that the current selection will be deleted and asking if we would like to continue with this action. By accepting this, we see that the product suggestion has changed because the properties of the refrigerant have changed. In this example, the evaporator and condenser temperatures have changed to dew point temperature because R404A is a glide refrigerant. We can view the technical performance data and check the application's calculations in the performance segment located at the bottom of the screen. Once we have our burnout filter selected, we can head to the code number selection tab located within the bottom segment of the screen to see the additional options such as connection types and materials. Next to each option is the product code number, which we can add to our bill of materials to obtain a quotation from a Danfoss supplier. We'll look at how to generate a bill of materials at the end of this video. To select a compressor, we start by selecting the compressor and condensing units tab, and then click on the compressor category. We must always start our selection process from the first segment located on the top left of the application window. Here we first specify the application the compressor will be used for and unselect any which aren't applicable. Then we choose which refrigerant we'll be using, followed by the power supply available. Underneath this, we can choose the type of compressor from reciprocating or scroll, and then whether we require fixed speed or variable speed. Finally, if needed, we could also specify which model we want, but this is optional. After that, we need to define the compressor's operating conditions. Remember to take time in this section to ensure the details are correct, as it will have a significant impact on our product suggestion. The table will populate a list of potentially applicable compressors. Of these, one compressor will be suggested. This is based on how closely it matches your capacity requirements. You can view this match by scrolling to the right-hand side of the chart. Some compressors have additional performance options which can be viewed or hidden by clicking on the plus or minus button located on the left-hand side of the chart. Products listed with red text are warning that the product falls outside the selection tolerance, which is defaulted at plus or minus 10%. The table can be expanded by clicking on the expand or contract button located on the top right corner of the segment. The information in the table can also be changed to show only the information required simply by right-clicking on the table headers and selecting manage columns. You can check the performance details for any product by selecting it from the list and then scrolling through the various tabs within the performance segment located at the bottom of the screen to find the relevant performance data, thermodynamic data, as well as spares, dimensions, mechanical or electrical data. The graphs can be viewed as tables by clicking on the radio buttons located just above the graph. This can then be exported to Excel by right-clicking on the table values and selecting Export to Excel. We can obtain product code numbers for a compressor by clicking on the Information tab located within the Performance segment at the bottom of the screen. The different options available for the compressor will be displayed here. In this example, it's asking whether we require a single compressor or an industrial six-pack of compressors. Next to the list item is a product code number, which can be added to the bill of materials to obtain a quotation from a Danfoss supplier. Additionally, we have the option to add spare parts to our bill of materials and find product code numbers for these additional components in the lowest section of the screen, within the Information tab. We'll look at how to generate a bill of materials at the end of this video. To select a case controller, simply click on the Electronic Controls tab and then select the Case Controllers category. We want to always start the selection process from the first segment located on the top left of the screen. We start by selecting which expansion valve we have. In this example, we'll choose an EEV AKV. Then we can select the type of refrigeration system. We'll select dual case for this example. After that, we need to tell the application how many compressors are being used. For this example, we'll just use a single compressor. We can then select any controls features or digital inputs we require, but for now we'll leave these. Under communications, we can select how this component will be connected and transmit information. In this example, we'll use Modbus, so we select Modbus as our communication method. You'll have noticed that the application controllers were narrowed down, and in this example, we now have a single controller suggested. Once we have narrowed down our product options and selected a case controller, the product code numbers will be displayed in the lowest section of the screen. This can be added to the bill of materials and provided to a Danfoss supplier for a quotation. We'll look at how to generate a bill of materials in the next section of this video. Now that we have our components and any spares selected, we can generate a bill of materials which can be provided to a Danfoss supplier for a quotation. To do this, we simply head to the Bill of Materials tab located in the menu bar at the top of the screen. We can now see all the items we selected, along with the quantity, a product description, and a product code numbers. Additionally, in the left-hand panel, we have the option to add a project name, some comments, as well as our name to the Bill of Materials. To do this, simply enter your text into the inputs and then click the Update button to apply the changes. The Bill of Materials can then be exported as an Excel or Word document by clicking the Export buttons along the top. If you need to add additional items or remove them from the bill of materials, just click the Selections tab in the top menu bar. Items can then be removed by clicking the X button next to the product tab title, or a new item can be added by clicking on the New tab button. You can also edit your current product selections. Once you're satisfied, just click the Bill of Materials button and your bill of materials will have updated. We can generate a report for our product selections by clicking on the Report button in the top menu bar. A report will then generate showing the technical information for each of our selections. We can further customize a report by adding or removing information by clicking on the plus buttons for the products listed in the left-hand panel under Items to include in the report. A number of options will then become visible and we can select or unselect these from the report. Once you make a change, simply click the Update button to apply this to the report. Additionally, we can add a project name, some comments, as well as our name to the report in the left-hand panel. Again, just click the Update button to apply these. Once you are satisfied with this report, you can then export this using the Export buttons located along the top just above the report. Okay, that's it for this video. Thank you very much for watching. We hope you enjoyed this and it has helped you. If so, please don't forget to like, subscribe, and share. If you have any questions, let us know in the comments section down below. You can also find links to more Coolselector tutorials in the video description. Do check those out. Once again, thanks for watching.